I think a lot of organizations do social media listening in one form or another, where you're going online to seeing what's being said about your brand. Social media intelligence takes it a step beyond that. Rather than just reading or listening and taking everything at face value, what we really want to do is take that data as a data source and really understand the behavior that's driving the data and the metrics and the comments that you see online, and using it to better understand your metrics, knowing what metrics to look at and knowing how that'll impact your strategy. Basically, what we want to measure is consumer opinion about our product, our online opinion. But what's going to influence that opinion expression? If we break it down, there's the who, what, and where of it. The who being not everybody is posting online. And I'm not just talking about a digital divide or young people being on social media more, but there are other systematic biases for those who are engaged online. And so what you're seeing in these communities it's not even a representative sample of people who are engaged online. It's a sample of the people who have really strong opinions. Okay. What are they expressed? What do they express online? And so there are different factors that influence the opinion that it gets expressed. It might be different from the underlying opinion that people actually hold. So the environment, the social context, will all cause people to say something more or less positive than what they actually believe underneath. And then the where is venue differences. So if we think about posting behavior, we can break it down into these three separate components. At the same time, all of these three components are interrelated, but we don't, as researchers, market researchers or academic researchers, we tend to ignore the fact that who posts, the sample that we see online, is related to what they're saying online, which is related to where exactly we're listening online. This is a framework that was proposed by a political scientist named Berinsky, where you have an underlying opinion formation process, followed by a formation expression process. And they're two distinct stages. So you can have an opinion about issues, about products, but that's not necessarily what you express to your friends, to your family, to your social media community. As marketers, which one do we care about? We care about the underlying true opinion. But what gets expressed online gets muddied by all sorts of other factors. And what we've identified are two factors. One is the selection effect and one is the adjustment effect. So there are some factors that cause some people to stay out of the conversation or to be more active in the conversation so that the population, the composition of the population participating online, is constantly changing. It's constantly shifting. Okay? It's not always going to represent the same sentiment and same opinions. At the same time, even if we have a representative sample participating online, what they express can still be biased by some of the social factors online. Okay? A couple of effects that have been identified in the research, we have expert effects. So those people, self-perceived experts who see themselves as experts, they tend to be more critical. You'll always get more negative comments because they think that enhances their expertise if they can point out the critical components. You also have multiple audience effects, which is when you have a diverse population of people that you're trying to talk to, it's much more difficult to have a clean message, a clean opinionated message. And so when you have a diverse audience, you tend to see more moderate opinions being expressed, more thought out opinions being expressed, just a little bit more depth as opposed to, you're not gonna see the I love it or I hate it comments. It's a lot more moderation. There are also bandwagon and differentiation effects where if everyone likes the product, even if you didn't really like it that much in the first place, you might go and say I like it anyway. Or some people differentiate, in particular the experts, that if everyone says it's a great product, the expert's gonna come in and say it's a terrible product, just to distinguish themselves as an expert from the population. And so there are a lot of these studies that show what we express online isn't necessarily the same as the opinions that we hold internally, okay? That has big implications for the metrics that we monitor, for how we interpret what people are saying online. Okay, and so let's talk a little bit about the dynamics that we find. So one thing is that because of the social interactions that you see online, that over time, ratings and reviews and the sentiment expressed, the positivity or negativity of the sentiment, tends to increase in variance. So as you get more people expressing their opinion, you're going to get a larger variety of opinions. But systematically, we also see this decline in sentiment. Okay, so there are several studies that have posited different hypotheses for it. So one study out of Wharton says it's a product lifecycle effect. And what they say is that early on in the product lifecycle, you have people providing opinions, but they have a different utility function. They value different aspects of the product than people who buy the product later. And so then the later customers will provide lower ratings for that product because they're less happy. Other studies have shown that as the population of opinions explodes in size, consumers have a harder time identifying other the raters that share, that might have similar preference functions as they have, and so they make poorer decisions. And what we're finding is that it's a systematic social interaction bias, that over time what happens is you might start with a group of activists with extreme opinions, and you might start with a much larger group of low involvement, moderate opinion holders. Okay? And over time what happens, if you think about those selection effects and the social interaction effects, you have the experts and the highly involved, they're getting more and more negative because they want to differentiate themselves as experts, so they provide more negative comments. The low involvement consumers actually don't like that dissension, right? They don't want to be engaged in this angry take down the brand argument online. So what happens to the composition of the posting population? It becomes dominated by the activists while the moderate consumers start pulling away. It doesn't mean that, as a whole, your product is doing worse over time. It just means that the environment online is conducive to a situation where the population is changing in its composition, and that the opinions getting expressed are subject to these social influence effects. So we have more and more activists over time and fewer low involvements. The data I'm going to be talking about is for an enterprise software company. And so there is... the data is, social media is more representative for this population, so all of these IT company folks are online talking about this brand and how it interfaces with the rest of the organization. But they still have a variety of venues that they can post to. So we have the red line up top is the average sentiment in blogs. The blue line is microblogs or Twitter. And so those two tend to be on the positive side. They're more positive than other venues. There are other venues, but they're sparser, so I haven't provided them here. Then the green line is discussion forums, the average sentiment in discussion forums. And you see a slight downward trend in discussion forums that you don't see in the other two. So you see that blogs and microblogs tend to be more positive. They tend to have less social interaction. When you have more social interaction in the case of discussion forums, you see this declining trend because of the social dynamics that I was just talking about. And when you see these three distinct patterns of sentiment across these venues, what do we do as researchers? Companies like Radian6 or Topsy or other social media firms, they take all of these comments and they pull them together, they give you an average. That's that dark line right there. But that misses a lot of the dynamics within a venue or misses the differences across venues. Other folks will focus just on Twitter, that blue line, but then you're missing all the issues that are happening in that green line for discussion forums. Okay? And so there are real differences across venues that we really need to take into account when we think about online sentiment. In terms of, so I mentioned the same company during the same period of time also ran an offline brand tracking survey. And so if we take each of these metrics on that plot and correlate it with that offline brand tracking survey, those are our correlations. They're all terrible, right? So the average sentiment is correlated 0.008. The best one, the strongest correlation is microblogs, and that's a negative correlation. And so if you're a market researcher, you're in charge of customer insights, and you have this brand tracking study, and you have all the social media data, and they're either not correlated or negatively correlated, that's a big problem for how you want to use social media research. Okay. So what's going on? So what we did was we built a statistical model. It's a hierarchical Bayesian model that basically tries to identify factors that might influence sentiment we have, you know, what gets expressed online is this overall sentiment, overall opinion, that's basically a compilation, an aggregation of a bunch of different factors. We have a general brand impression, an opinion toward, an underlying opinion toward the brand as a whole, but then we also have all these other factors that are changing or influencing what you express online in terms of your opinion. The venue you decide to post to is going to affect whether your opinion is more or less positive. You've got dynamics within some venues and not in others that are going to change the opinion you express. And you've got the focal message topic. So you might love Apple overall, but you're not going to go onto social media to talk about how much you love your Apple. You might go onto social media to complain about a particular battery life issue. It doesn't mean you don't like Apple. So that what you express, the sentiment of what you express, is distinct from your opinion toward the brand, and that's something we need to separate out. The point of all this is try to see if we can use that social media data to really to correlate with our offline brand tracking surveys. Because if we can't identify the relationship between online and offline, then it's always just going to be a fun toy to satisfy our curiosities. Okay. And so if we look at the measure of interest is that general brand impression after we take out all those biasing factors. And this is a plot of survey sentiment, which is our dotted line. That's what they got from their offline phone survey with their customers. They ran these surveys on a rolling basis. So they had waves of surveys implemented every month. The dark line is our GBI measure, lagged by a month. And you can see there's some lining up of that. When we don't lag it, our correlation is terrible. Well, it's not terrible, it's not good. We see that GBI is still not correlated with our offline survey. If we look at our specific forums, specific venues, they're also poorly correlated with our offline surveys. But when we lag our GBI, look, that's our correlation jumps up to 0.881. Okay. Huge improvement. This is actually something that I would feel comfortable making decisions off of, saying that if we control for all these factors, we have a measure of brand sentiment from social media that tracks our offline efforts pretty well. Okay. So why is it lagged? It's much faster, right? Social media is instantaneous. Any sort of social media data is much more timely. If you were to invest in a survey or commission a survey, it takes time for them to make all the phone calls, for them to fill out the surveys, for them to compile the results. And so this isn't anything earth-shattering, it's just a timing issue. But it does say that there is this potential for social media to be a good lead indicator for brand measures, for our brand sentiment, for our brand general brand impression or offline brand tracking surveys. I think I don't want to overstep and say it's going to replace surveys, because surveys you can actually get to specific issues of interest, whereas social media you're just kind of letting people talk about what they want to talk about rather than talk about things that you want to learn about. Okay, but in terms of being able to track how well your brand is, your brand health, there's a potential for a pretty good measure here. Just as further evidence, I also compared it to some stock market prices for the same firm. And if you think about what's going to drive stock market prices, you've got the general market performance or our S&P index. We threw in a GBI and a lagged GBI as predictor variables. R-squared's not great. But we do see a significant effect of the lagged GBI term influencing our stock market price. Okay. When we do the same regression or same analysis for Twitter comments, blogs, forums, we don't get the same relationship. And depending on the data set, sometimes microblogs are more predictive, sometimes forums are more predictive of stock market price. But regardless of the data set we use, GBI comes across as a significant predictor if we lag it by one period. From the research, we know that social dynamics exist, significant social dynamics exist to cause the expressed sentiment online to be either more or less positive than what the consumers truly hold underneath, right? And the way to deal with this is to basically encourage a variety of opinions. What companies, especially small and medium-sized businesses, tend to do is they're afraid of social media. They're afraid of having their customers talk about their product because they don't know what they're going to say. But what we've found that is if you have a variety, if you encourage all opinions and not just your positive opinions, you get a healthier discussion and your sales are more insulated from that one or two outlier negative comments. So when you're afraid of those negative comments, rather than only exclusively asking for the positive comments to come in, which might actually invite those negative expert differentiators, you want to really encourage a wide variety and get a healthy conversation going. That also provides a better source of marketing research data if you wanted to use social media intelligence as a source of data. Social media behavior also varies noticeably across venue formats. And so the implication for that is when we look to social media, when we listen online, we really want to monitor a variety of venues, but we don't want to just blindlessly aggregate them. We want to take into account the differences across venues. We also don't want to focus on just one venue, Twitter, basically, because each venue is systematically different from the other venues. We also need to account for the prevalence of particular attributes on social media. Not all attributes are equally represented, and it's not a function of how important those attributes are to the consumer. It's more a function of what's more buzzworthy, so to speak. Okay. And then finally, there's a potential to use social media for market research. If you extract all of those biasing effects and end up with this one underlying brand impression measure, that requires, if in a sparse data situation, that requires a statistical model. Short of a model-based measure, you know, at the very least, we need to be monitoring disaggregated measures for particular products, for specific characteristics, rather than averaging everything together.